Okay. Okay. Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to ENERGIZED. I hope you're all doing well. My name is Steve Levin. I am CEO of Solar One, and it is wonderful to see you all. I'm very excited to introduce this amazing and dynamic panel discussion, the future of sustainability and resiliency in New York City, policy and development. Your moderator will be renowned author, developer, urban revitalization strategist, MacArthur Fellow, Peabody Award winner, lecturer at Princeton University's Keller Center, and Solar One board member, Majora Carter. We are very excited to hear from this extraordinary panel. As many of you know, about 70% of New York City's greenhouse gas emissions come from our buildings. The only way that our generation will reduce our city's carbon footprint is through the built environment, and our panelists today are some of the leaders who will be making that happen in the years to come. Without further ado, I would like to introduce our moderator, Majora Carter, and she will introduce our wonderful panelists. Thank you all so much for joining us.
Well, hello. I hope you guys have had a wonderful day. I know I did, and I'm so looking forward to this panel being like the end of a really fabulous day. So get ready, and you know, I'm super excited as well. So I am really happy to be here, and so I want to. So by way of introduction, I'm just going to do the brief sentence of who they are, and then each one of these folks are going to do a 3-minute presentation, just to, as way of introduction, because what better way to help understand people in their own words and what they do and why. So we're just going to. So this is who's here, and actually, conveniently enough, we did not organize it, but they all ended up where the way that they're going to talk. So there you go. Elijah Hutchinson is the new executive director of New York City's Mayor's Office of Climate and Environmental Justice. Daniel Sundlin is architect and partner at the Big, or BIG. I'm not going to try to say it in Danish, sorry. And Jared Della, Valle is CEO and founder of Alloy Development. And Kate Selden is the policy analyst at Solar One. Yay, so give them all a hand. And we're going to start with Elijah.
Hi, everybody. So I am the new executive director of the Mayor's Office of Climate and Environmental Justice. So new, I just started 2 weeks ago, right before the giant rainstorm hit on my first week. And it was a crash course in the preparedness and resilience of the city, and something that we all know as stakeholders and people who live in New York, which is there's a lot of work that we have to do and that the climate is changing a lot faster than our infrastructure is able to adapt and adjust. We are a mayor's office that includes the title of environmental justice within our climate work, and we're the first office in New York City to have that title. We released the strategic climate plan for the city of New York, which includes energy, transportation, waterways, green jobs, waste, open space, and really thinking about setting forward what our policy objectives are, and then working with all of the city agencies and stakeholders to make sure we can get there. The image that's behind you is right when we released the latest edition of Plan YC, which is the first climate plan released by this administration, the Adams administration, but is a plan that's required to get updated every 4 years. We just released our latest version a few months ago to great fanfare, and here the mayor is actually switching on the solar array that was installed on the former Sheepshead Bay High School in Brooklyn, one of many sites that we have across the city, part of our goal to maximize solar installation across every city-owned asset where feasible. And that's an acknowledgement of a lot of the work that we need to do, and you all know how, you know, the challenges of some of that. But what's really, really important is that we find every opportunity possible that we find the resources and the rules to be able to actually move forward with installation. And so far, we have 80% of our public solar that we've done has been in 80 projects with schools in New York City on top of roofs, which is really, really, really impressive, both for the Department of Education in our school system, but also for the students who are inside of those buildings who get to see what solar looks like and get to benefit from the air quality and other benefits that we all know and appreciate with educational visualization and tools that those solar rays really provide to the people that are inside of the buildings. So really excited to be here.
Thank you. Okay, Daniel.
Sure. Hi, everyone. And thank you for having me here. My name is Daniel Sundlin. I am a partner at Bjarke Ingels Group, or BIG, or BIG. I'm very excited to be here today. So I'm trained as an architect and have spent roughly 12 years here in New York. I moved here, speaking of timing, I moved here in 2011, and 2012 I moved to the Lower East Side. And about 1 month later, Sandy hit. And it was like the first time I realized why like American weathercasts are so dramatic. It's like, holy shit, weather here is a totally different ballgame than back home in Sweden. I'm here today. I wanted to share a couple of, let's say, ideas and ways of thinking about projects that we are working on. So BIG is a international firm. We're about 800 people globally. We have an office in Dumbo. We've been here for 12 years, so I was here starting out the office together with a few colleagues. And over the years, we've been moving from doing more buildings to get involved in infrastructure. And I truly believe that the future is really about marrying design and infrastructure in an intelligent and more kind of long-term thinking. There are seven themes here. Actually, these different projects are now on display at Governor's Island. We have an exhibition together with Pratt Institute. So if anybody is around this weekend, it's going to be the last weekend, I highly recommend to check it out. But essentially, this idea of thinking about how we can adapt to more dense coastal and kind of exposed future, where today it's quite mind-blowing that almost half of the world's population live within 100 miles of a coastline, 3.5 billion people, and that number is growing and growing. That's where the majority of the people of the future will live, and in the cities that we have today. So we've been thinking a lot about how can we build cities of the future in a way so the future residents are more safe and obviously more comfortable, and also cities that are more enjoyable. From left to right, the East Side Coastal Resiliency is a project we started after Sandy. So we essentially started to work on a coastal resiliency project here in Manhattan. And it was the first project where I got exposed to the idea of kind of combining architecture, landscape, and infrastructure. It's been a very interesting 10 years, and it's under construction at first 2.3 miles. And it's protecting 150,000 people. We're also working on a project in Williamsburg, where we have been taking quite a different approach. So instead of protecting the city with a kind of a elevated park, we are looking into actually creating wetlands and beaches, and essentially creating the first kind of a natural habitat for people to enjoy. And then a couple of other examples: floating. We developed a student housing called the Urban Rigger out of 9 different containers. We're now housing the first 100 students. So we think this idea of like not only occupying land, but actually like thinking about the rivers and the waters around the city as an opportunity. And of course, Solar One, I've been involved together with Solar One to develop the the new educational center on the that actually sits within the Eastside Coastal Resiliency Project. So it's very exciting. We just broke ground for a month ago, I think, and it's going to be finished in a year approximately. Yeah. Don't quote me on that, but I think that's the plan at least. And then also maybe I just quickly connect. We've been working with redesigning the infrastructure on Brooklyn Bridge, and it's a really interesting project because historically Brooklyn Bridge used to house 300 or basically transport 375,000 people per day, but today it only transport 125,000 people per day. And why is that? It's because instead of public transportation, we're now moving people with cars. So instead of moving people, we're actually moving things. So something we're really passionate about is to rethink how we connect with each other. And then finally, we designed a waste-to-energy plant back in Copenhagen, Scandinavia, with a ski slope on top of it. Awesome. And it was just an exciting way of turning the backside of the city into a new center. And then finally, we're doing a repurposing a old power plant upstream, so I was about to say, in Yonkers. So I really believe that we should, that there's a lot of ways we can think about resiliency and sustainability to create a better future for New York and every other Excellent. Coastal city. Sorry, it was more than 3 minutes.
It was, but don't worry, I got you on the back end. So Jared, please.
Hi, I'm Jared Della Valle. I need to learn to put 7 images up instead of 1 so I can sneak in more information. Alloy is a architect-led real estate development company. There's about 20 of us in our office, and we work exclusively in Brooklyn. And we're mission-based, and that might sound weird being a real estate concern, but being mission-based, but we believe in making Brooklyn beautiful, equitable, and sustainable. There's an obligation we feel like we carry. Being architect-led, all of us, or 17 of the 21 of us, having come from architecture, have this embedded value set about what we believe and sort of what's right, and we watch our peer set struggle with their clients in trying to convince them what the right thing to do is. And as a developer and having agency over that decision, we had no choice but to look at ourselves to kind of make the difficult decisions. So we try to do one project at a time. The project you're seeing behind you is the Alloy Block downtown, which is a little over 1 million square feet. As we've continued to grow, our aspirations have grown about what the private markets can achieve from a sustainability perspective. And we're currently building New York City's first all-electric skyscraper, New York City's first passive house school for SCA. And it's the first LEED community. And we have another, call it 600,000 square feet to go, and that's TBD. But let's just say it'll be more sustainable than the other stuff that we've done to date.
That's crazy. Okay, anyway, thank you for that. Cool. Kate, please.
Is this on?
Yes. So my name's Kate Selden, and I'm the policy analyst at Solar One. And I primarily work in the Here Comes Solar team, which, for those that don't know, is our is a team of my amazing colleagues, many of whom are here today. And they try to make solar more affordable and accessible, particularly for marginalized communities that have historically faced the highest barriers to accessing solar and also face the highest energy burden, so stand to benefit from solar. And so my team does this by providing technical assistance to all kinds of buildings across the city, affordable housing, community organizations, low-income homeowners and co-ops, and many other types of buildings, and really tries to facilitate solar projects and reduce barriers. And so my role is to take these on-the-ground lessons that we're encountering in these technical assistance and really make sure that they're translated and present in the policy world so that we have more equitable policy that that really works on the implementation side. And so just to kind of give one example to highlight kind of this intersection of policy and implementation is, you know, recently, I'm sure if you're in this room, you probably have heard of the Inflation Reduction Act. And so that was, groundbreaking climate law passed last year. And much of the investment was in the form of tax credits. And a really big one was for solar. And so, so as an example, one of the buildings that recently came to us is very near and dear to my heart. This is a community organization called Los Sudes, where I used to work. They do affordable housing development and other community services, and are basically looking to go solar on a senior affordable building. And from my experience working there, you know, we know how hard it is to just preserve affordable housing in the city. You're just working on really tight margins, trying to keep the lights on and keep the building just at basic functioning level. So it can be really hard to even think about things like solar. So my team is working with Los Sudes to figure out how to do this. And because of the Inflation Reduction Act, you know, one of the really important things about it was that it included something called direct pay. And so, you know, there's a federal tax credit for solar that historically nonprofits couldn't access because they don't pay federal income taxes. And so with the Inflation Reduction Act, now nonprofits like Los Sudes can get that incentive as a direct payment the year after they go solar. So that's really big for them. And then, you know, another program in the Inflation Reduction Act is this bonus credit for solar in low-income communities. And so when the rules for that program came out, we took our experience working with groups like Los Sudes and worked with other affordable housing folks to make sure that the rules were written in a way that was easy to access so that you know, projects could really happen. And you know, groups like Los Sudes had the flexibility to really implement and take advantage of these credits. And so, you know, because of the advocacy of this coalition of groups, they did change the rules and they made it a little bit easier. So so I'll be working with my team to figure out how we can now work with Los Sudes to access those credits.
Cool. Well, thank you so much. And I have to say, there's a beautiful segue to some of the questions that I really want to get to. And I love, Kate, you know, how you sort of framed it in the ways like you're matching policy and implementation so that it actually, like, the things that we value, you know, as an organization, Florida Solar One's board, so I'm just pushing that out there as well. So, but how do you, what are some of the other ways in which you think New York City could actually scale more access to solar? Because that was a really beautiful example, but obviously there's a lot more that we can do. So what are some other ways?
Sure. I mean, I've got a long list, to name a few, I kind of like to think about it as, you know, how do we make solar the status quo? How do we make sure it's business as usual and not this, like, shiny thing that is hard to get? And so there's a couple buckets I think about that in. One is, you know, thinking about the makeup of our city is, I think, over half renters. And so realistically, if we're going to scale solar and get solar to the masses, it's not just about putting solar on every rooftop. We really have to make sure that our community solar sector is flourishing. And so community solar, you know, is where you put a solar elsewhere in the city, and renters or people who can't put it on their own roofs can subscribe and get savings on their bills. And this is going to be huge if we really want to bring both the savings of solar, particularly to low-income communities, but also just for tall, skinny buildings that can't put solar on their own roofs, like the Alloy. And so I think we need to make sure there's policies in place that really support this. This sector, we need physical space to do that. And I know the city has, you know, the Department of City Planning is putting forth a zoning proposal to unlock more physical space, so we're really supportive of that. And then I think, you know, in addition to just scaling up community solar and all the incentives that are required to do that, it's also about making solar business as usual for development, mm-hmm. and making sure that, you know, permitting is streamlined and that it's like any other trade. You get an architect, you get a plumber, you get an electrician, you get a solar installer. Mm-hmm. So I think, you know, really bolstering the workforce to be able to do that is important too.
Awesome, thank you so much. And Jared, so you sort of used the phrase developer and mission in the same sentence, and you mentioned that, you know, as a developer, you know, you can make certain decisions. And a lot of that was tied to your mission. So can you kind of talk about being an architect-led development company, you know, as it relates to your mission?
Yeah, it's interesting. The use of the word value or the use of the word equity in the real estate space means different things than the conversation that we're having today, right? On On the equity side of things, of course, that's gross, that's capital, but not having anything to do with social equity or social capital in a really important way. And the word value in general, in our context, means different things at different times and different places. And oftentimes, value can mean something to the community in a very different way than it can be for our investors, as an example, or our lenders. I think the biggest way that we end up controlling the outcome for like what the decisions that we make is we use as much of our own capital as we can, and we invite investors at the very last minute. And at that point, we have a fully formed development plan. It's ready to stick the shovel in the ground, and people have to agree on the value set. And we talk openly about the values, mm-hmm. not the economic value, as an investment thesis and criteria. And in fact, that's proving to be quite provocative these days. We were told, you know, I think we were the first ground-up development that was financed from Goldman Sachs post-COVID, and their credit committee commented that if it weren't for our social mission and our sustainability mission, they would not have invested, right? And it was the beginning of, you know, if we're going to invest in New York now in an uncertain time.
Wait, so that we're all clear, was the ROI like the... I'm so sorry. Was the economic ROI actually lower, and they were actually looking at ROI in a different way?
No, I think, I don't think so. It's hard for me to judge because I'm not on an investment committee, but there are clearly threshold issues for investment. Mm-hmm. And I think at that point it was, we're going to do nothing because of the unknown, or we can do something and lead, right? And
got it.
At that moment they were judging like, what do we actually do for business? And if we're going to do business in New York, what are the things that we should be talking about? And that was the first time, certainly, that we've received that feedback. But that was also the first time that we kind of wore it on our sleeve as hard as we did. You know, like it was a significant moment, you know, with Black Lives Matter happening, with all of the other like things happening in the world at that particular moment from a sustainability issue or public health and safety issue, where we just kind of drove right at it. Mm-hmm. And the returns were not footnoted, but they, I think, became a threshold issue that was just different. We're just trying to have different conversations.
Yeah, I love it. I'm glad. Yeah, because it's interesting that you know, equity, you and value, actually even on a community level, like especially lower income communities would love more equity, like the green kind, as well as the social kind. I mean, that's one of the problems that we have. I'm so sorry. I'm just used to being sort of loud, and but I guess not so much. Yeah, so this is really kind of helpful, but I am, so I'm gonna throw this to you, Daniel. We're talking about equity and value. You know, how do you think we can develop cities around people and communities instead of the other way around?
No, it's a great question. I think it's interesting when you look at like cities historically were built around making things and repairing things, and they were built around, let's say, a smaller scale opportunities. And I think there is something about the kind of new green technology and thinking about food production within cities, essentially bringing infrastructure back to the communities, bringing the control of infrastructure back to communities. And by doing so, not only creating resiliency and sustainability, but also this idea of actually creating kind of microeconomic opportunities to engage more with your environment and your and the urban life. So I truly believe that we're in this kind of interesting moment in time where we're going to move from a kind of this kind of centralized idea of support system that are like away from the cities to start to bring some of these support system and infrastructure that we rely on into the communities, and by doing so creating more resiliency and sustainability, like urban farming or vertical farming, greenhouses, solar energy, wind energy, collecting water, creating more parks, greenscape that actually contribute to the kind of overall biomass and health of our planet.
Yeah, that's interesting. As I, again, I love value and equity as part of these conversations and challenging the idea that value and equity are somehow different when we're talking about the people that I think, especially even Solar One, like works to support, you know, in quote unquote communities. And I think that's, if you think about them, like the lower income communities of color here in the city. And but really, they need the value and the equity as well. Like, again, the green kind and not just the social kind, the one that actually helps accrue wealth creation and generation, et cetera. And so you, Elijah, oh my goodness. So
I was hoping you would.
Say,
I was hoping, yeah.
Yes, and so we've got, so you're, which I find really hard to believe that there's, New York City's never had any office with the title of environmental justice in its name.
Mayor's office. Yeah.
Okay.
Maybe there's another office somewhere.
Maybe. You know what? Maybe somewhere. But so this is, I'm, so now, but I mean, part of the idea and focus mm-hmm. around environmental justice was not just talking about the harms that are done, you know, to low-income communities of color that, you know, to be bearing the burden of environmental impacts, but also like reaping some of the benefits, mm-hmm. you know, and the green economy has never really kind of made its way into mm-hmm. Our communities. So if you could talk a little bit more about you, how you in this coming role, you know, what do you see, you know, as a gap in opportunity to improve the fact that even the benefits of better environmental and sustainability policies have somehow not always, you know, been like accruing to those communities as much as they could have?
Yeah, thank you. I think that a lot of the times we misunderstand what we mean by equity and who benefits from the mm-hmm. equity perspective, but our goals in New York City and in New York State are so aggressive. Complete decarbonization, 100% renewable energy by 2050. We can't get there without bringing everybody along. It is technically impossible to do so, and so you have to make sure that there are the resources and capacity and partnerships in place to be able to have that transition. And then how do you ensure a just transition when you're going about that? And one of the pieces that I, you know, stepping into this role only a few weeks ago, but something that I bring from my background at the Economic Development Corporation is always just making sure we have that jobs perspective and that it's inextricably linked to our investments. And one of the benefits of our office is not only do we release the strategic plan for the city, which was Plan YC under Bloomberg, One NYC under de Blasio, now it's the Getting Sustainability Done plan, or GSD, or Getting Stuff Done plan under Adams. But we also release the, and we will be releasing the city's first equity plan. And that plan is also required to be updated every 4 years. And we're also the office that is released, that has released the city's first energy plan called Power Up, which just got released on my first day 3 weeks ago. And so those kinds of intersections in order to achieve equity, I think you have to tie all of that together, because it's not just the programmatic approach. It has to be the strategic plan, it has to be the equity plan, and it has to be the energy plan. And while those are all coming out of the same office, and might seem like separate documents or might fall flat in the public, I think it's up to us as decision makers, policy makers, to really think through these things so that it works for people on the ground, because I think everyone is watching now with the amount of money that's coming or hopefully coming from the federal government. And we're gonna need to do things like public solar, and we're applying for hundreds of millions of dollars to be able to have renters access, low-income households access those solar resources. Because that's going to be what's necessary, and we can't, you know, have these. It's amazing to have the development perspective at the table as well, because it's we have to hit all of those all of this from many different sides. And so, my thing is, you know, as government, where we have a role is setting those policy objectives, but then also being first movers. The decarbonization goals for the public sector that we have are even more strict than what are in the private sector for Local Law 97 and other policy objectives. So we have to spend that money and be the first movers, and, you know, might not make sense from an ROI perspective necessarily, but that's the role we have to play. And then I think tying it to a green jobs framework, which we're working with the Economic Development Corporation to release a green jobs plan that I think is coming out soon, within months, to make sure we have a real focus on the pipeline of employment, because that is what ultimately I think people see and feel the real difference, is making sure it's connected to people's pocketbooks.
Yeah, and since we have a little time, let's just, if it's not in there, I would suggest making sure that there's like a path to entrepreneurship and the green economy in that, because otherwise it's just, like, I mean, I'm delighted. Absolutely. As a leader in the green jobs movement way back in the day, I feel like where we fell short was actually ensuring that folks in those communities were also owners of businesses, mm-hmm. and the playing field's obviously not level to get them in there, but that's something that the mayor's office and the city could do to help make sure that we prepare people in advance of that.
Yeah, and to that point, we're also seeing that there's a role for the public sector with all of the assets that we own. We're one of the largest landlords in New York City, yep. and we own and operate thousands and thousands of square feet of industrial manufacturing facilities. And so, you know, we're working with Industry City and others in Sunset Park to make sure that we provide startup spaces for companies that are looking to locate, and then also tying that to the workforce development initiatives in those communities as well, to tie those investments back to jobs. But it's using our assets and public infrastructure for our public policy priorities and making sure we don't lose focus on that.
So thank you for that. We'll talk more. But anywho, so I just have one more question that's going to go to all of the panelists, and then we want to make sure that we have time to throw it to y'all. So what do you think in the past has gotten in the way of more happening? Like, Jared, I know you doing the first all-electric skyscraper, which is, like, really, really cool, right? But, gosh, it would have been so cool if, like, you're the first. Which is cool, but, I mean, it could have happened a long time ago.
It shouldn't have been.
It should have been. It should have been, like, done, like, many times by this time. Yeah. But anyway, but that's to all of you. What's gotten in the way? Like, what's been the challenge in your minds of why we're not there and what could happen more? So you give some examples.
You want me to start?
Yeah, might as well.
I guess the real estate industry is, it looks backwards. Developers are optimists and they have an obligation to look forward, but most families, most valuations, most appraisals, everything is backward looking. And very few families own, and very few institutions own, the preponderance of real estate in New York City. And they operate real estate in a certain way. And they refine that process, and they have a way of doing things that becomes very difficult. We become disruptors because we're new at it, right? It seems preposterous, right? We don't have a portfolio. This is our first rental building. And so I don't need to look at our other rental buildings and say, well, how do we maintain this electric resistance boiler? It's like, I don't give a shit. We're going to maintain it. Just, we'll figure it out. Like, and we don't need to worry about it. We can experiment, we can try, we can provoke. And, you know, I remember the conversations deeply internally, which, like, why did this even happen? And it was because our governor was in a fight with National Grid over whether we would even get gas. Right? Like, and so it was like, all right, let's do electric. You know, like, it was just, wow. It was kind of a dumb response to the problem, but it was also not an engineering thing that had happened, right? And so I think it's candidly, the industry is quite conservative, and I think real estate concerns are conservative.
Yeah.
And there's opportunities for folks like us, hopefully, to lead the way and provoke and show change can happen. And we'll make mistakes. It won't be right, right? In a weird way, we did it 4 years ago. The technology has changed so dramatically since we did the building. It's not the most efficient building. It'll be carbon neutral, though. And so part of the question is, how much does efficiency matter if the energy is green? There's a lot of arguments on both sides of that equation, but at the time, there were like two people who made electric resistance boilers who could handle that kind of capacity for hot water production. We didn't have, you know, the type of technology we have, air source, heat pumps, or other things that can produce energy or electricity or hot water much more efficiently than we can.
Anybody? Next up. I'll add that I have found within project design, you can't just retrofit your energy solutions on top of something that especially I used to do a lot of our coastal infrastructure work, and if you're not energy planning at the beginning and thinking about all the spatial implications, it becomes really difficult to try and bring energy to the conversation later on once you've decided a lot about the programming and what the site's going to be and the components of the site. And having that having that goal up front and be very clear, I think is going to be really important for a lot of our big public infrastructure projects, so that it's fully integrated into the design and is something that works for people. I find we also have a really big communications problem when we're talking about solar or energy. A lot of the language that's being used is very inaccessible. When we're talking in terms of local laws and other rules, I think we often lose people. Mm-hmm. And we have a lot of work to do to meet people where they are, both in terms of language and resources, and acknowledging you know, that this can be very challenging. And so there's going to need to be a lot of handholding, particularly for lower capacity, smaller building owners who are going to need to have a resource to really handhold them through this process. Because New York City, as you know, is full of a diverse array of types of owners. And we're going to need to develop products that are specific to that, to those populations. And so I encourage everyone to go to our Building Accelerator website. It's our one-stop shop for building owners that are looking to be in compliance, to get the project management support that they need, to tie together resources that might be available with specific retrofit projects. But we need to, you know, retool those resources, have more of those resources, and also, you know, speak the language of what people are speaking, so that we can make sure that these projects happen.
I can add, yeah, I mean, I think, you know, part of the problem is there's a lot of money in the status quo, and mm-hmm. there's a lot of money to be made off of fossil fuel infrastructure, and I think it's taken, you know, early adopters to show that actually, and back to the conversation about value, that you can generate a lot of value in all the senses by taking a new path, but without interventions from policies, from incentive programs to really bolster an entire ecosystem of at solar, for example, where you have a workforce that's more secure and stabilized, where, you know, installers know that there's going to be projects for the next 10 years because there's an incentive in place for a long time. Or you have incentives that especially incentivize, you know, unique projects that maybe don't have a return on investment, but bring benefits to, you know, low-income communities and residents. And so I think, you know, you need these kind of programs that are really intentional about how they're directing resources, so that it becomes there's more value generated from mm-hmm. from making that switch than there has been from the status quo, which is fossil fuels. Mm-hmm. So I think.
Yeah, no, I think it's, I'm going to make it fairly brief here, but no, I think it's interesting this idea that there is this disconnect between value creation and essentially the investment, and in the way that you have like a, basically you have a lot of projects that are good design, they open the door, but they don't invite people to take part of it. And I believe great design makes that difference. You can actually, there is a difference between open the door and expect people to come and join the party and actually tell them that you can come here. And for 20 years ago, actually an interesting example, we designed our first harbor bath. It was actually one of the first buildings we did in Copenhagen. We designed a harbor bath, and everybody said, "Are you completely crazy? The harbor is like so dirty, you can't be there, nobody's gonna be there, nobody's gonna go there." And we designed this harbor bath, and we knew at the time that the water is actually perfectly fine, but people's perception is what's wrong. And of course, you start to get young people there, and suddenly this kind of backside of the city turns into the new kind of urban living room, if you will. And today it's probably like 20 harbor baths in the middle of Copenhagen. And that's why I think like this kind of perfect marriage of like design and kind of public initiatives and the private sector, it's like when that happens, you can actually move the needle, but you need everybody to be involved and do their best and believe in some new ideas.
Cool. So first of all, I just want to make sure when you say baths, you mean pools, right?
Yes, okay, pools.
Cool. Just making sure.
It's my Swedish.
I'm a plain interpreter. It's very exciting. Scandinavian house, I am that interpreter. Anyway, but so now we're going to open it up to the audience. So hi. Okay, so wait, don't say anything until you have a mic in front of your face. Don't be like me.
I can do that. Hi. Thank you very much for all your insightful comments today. I was just wondering what the city and what you, the private sector, are doing to prepare the workforce of the future to be able to do these jobs and be the solar panel installers, et cetera.
I'll mention we're working on the certification and training programs that are necessary for solar installation. There's a lot of work that could be done there. One of the things I learned from working within a development space is that a lot of times it's hard for the programs that certify people to be able to predict the pipeline of available work. And so we need to do a better job of really communicating like what is coming, because there's so much with the installation that's necessary, with the retrofit work that's necessary. There's an incredible amount of employment, and I do have some numbers here around like by 2030 we estimate 289,000 jobs, and in 2021 that's 149,000 jobs in the private sector in this space. So it's and that's an incredible amount of resource that is coming online. So we have to make sure we backtrack in timeline to what we need now, the partnerships with schools and institutions and others to make sure that that workforce is ready.
Yeah.
And there's a green economy action plan coming out soon, so.
Can I just add, I'd be remiss not to mention Solar One's amazing workforce and education departments that are, we're not the private sector or the public sector, but we're the nonprofit sector. So they're training folks for, you know, solar among other green jobs. And then we have a community engagement team that's really trying to connect workers who are coming out of these training programs to the jobs that exist. So I think that's, hugely important. And I think and then the work that the solar team does is really trying to solve problems so that the solar market expands so that there are more jobs. And so I think they're all related. There has to be a place to go for people coming out of programs so that they gain work experience. And then also I think the part you mentioned, Majora, of entrepreneurship and supporting small businesses and MWBEs to be able to diversify the solar industry so that there's more types of businesses out there.
Sorry, Santos Rodriguez with the New York City Building Trades. And so the part of workforce and workforce development, I think some of us got stumped there, right? However, thanks to Solar One as well, and contributing to a project or a program that I come out of almost 20, 25 years ago now, the Edu J. Malloy Initiative for Construction Skills is a pre-apprenticeship program that helps inner city students and adults come in. We work with four pre-apprenticeship programs here in New York City, right? Construction skills being one of them. New, non-traditional employment for women being a next, right? Helmets to Hard Hats, which is a veterans program. And then Pathways to Apprenticeship, which is the youngest one to the group, but helps with service, justice involved individuals, right? So really giving opportunities to an array of different individuals, not one shoe fits all, but with the partnerships that we continue with the City of New York, folks like Solar One and developers thinking about, we've spoken about equity here, we've spoken about communities, right? We've really got to maintain the workforce and make sure that the workers' equity and the just transition work really, gives opportunity to communities in that I come from, right? with wages and benefits, right? We haven't mentioned that at all, and I think that's important because that's the health of our communities as well, with developers, you know, born and raised in Brooklyn, no longer there, but gives us an opportunity to really uplift our community through and through, right? We think about affordable energy, right? This helps to that, and it helps families, not just one individual. So thank you so much for the opportunity.
Hi, Santos. Hi, my name is Carol Wacy. Majora, I want to go back to something you talked about, which is, you know, we've come a long way, but we really have, it's kind of surprising we haven't done more by now. I sat on something called the President's Council on Sustainable Development back in 1992. Oh. And this was laid out way back then. Now, just to tag on to what Santos was saying, you know, I've had the great pleasure of working with Solar One, both on the education side with a nonprofit called Mouse, and now at New, which Santos mentioned, the non-traditional employment for women. Talk a little bit about, and I love the fact that we have developers and architects and everyone talking about values. That's a big step forward. Sadly, it's a big step forward, but it is a big step forward we have to acknowledge. What do you see as the opportunity? I think on the education side, to get to the workforce, we got to make sure young people are part of that process. So even as you were showing the solar panels on top of schools, one of the great programs we did with Solar One back 15 years ago was making sure kids were involved in developing that. So you build the workforce early on, you get them excited about it. They really understand what's happening in the building. Same with, we work with women in construction, making sure they're a part of the process. They're, you know, a big part of the backbone of the city. So how do we make sure they're also involved? So I'd love any thoughts on that, just to make sure everybody, we talk about equity, but everybody is really a part of the process, from young kids and then making sure women and unions and everybody is really integrated in that process in any way possible. It'd be just interesting to get your thoughts on that.
I'm happy to step in for a second. I think the part of our job is to express demand and massive demand and create the opportunity for jobs, right? We're building a vertical skyscraper, so in a lot of cases, it's difficult to connect the fabrication or installation of solar panels that happen in grid J, but that are distant from our site, right? But creating the demand creates the workforce, and we support that. A lot of what you're talking about requires us to play the long game, right? Which is thinking way ahead about green collar jobs that don't currently exist, educating carpenters as an example about how to build a passive house, which is different than building a traditional stick-built house, or electricians to address the conversion of solar power through an inverter into electrical power, right? Like, there's a lot of skills that require training now, and it's a real opportunity for the next generation. In our case, we're building schools. That is, you know, part of our demands to the city, candidly, and it was a little bit of a, you know, holding the city ransom in some cases about whether or not we would do the project at all if we couldn't do passive house. But part of that is the city has to use this as a teaching opportunity for the students and to build awareness amongst the Arabic community in that case, because it's a dual language Arabic speaking high school, with their families, right? And how do we create awareness? We're providing free OSHA training and job training and other things in the local community. We have a community advocate that's literally trying to create local jobs and as many local jobs as we possibly can. And we're trying to hold ourselves accountable to a set of standards that don't exist, right? But it's important to, like, continue to show what the potential is, right? But it requires a lot of intentionality. Appreciate your point.
So I'm Shannon. I work in electrification of transportation, and so that, you know, wasn't as much what we were talking about on the panel today, but obviously there are huge policy pushes to electrify the transportation sector. Local Law 97 is coming on with buildings, and then we see over the summer there are these reports coming out that there's going to be this reliability gap, right, in a couple of years where Con Ed is saying, we're not going to have enough electricity to power all of these very needed changes. And we talked a lot about what was keeping us from getting to this point to date and just kind of looking just a little bit in the future, that's one of the pitfalls that I'm worried about, right? There's going to be this backlash of like, oh, we aren't ready for this. Why are all these policies coming down the pipe? One, should I be worried about that? But two, setting that aside, just what are those pitfalls that you would see as being potential headwinds to this very needed change, and how can we potentially avoid those headwinds?
I know that we have to work really, really closely with our utilities on this, because as they think about this question, when they make some of these decisions around replacing something that they have in kind, it might seem a lot less complicated or simple than what it is, but you're locking in, 10, 20 years of the wrong technology, perhaps, when you start to look at really large scale systems planning and the decarbonization that we need to do with National Grid, Con Edison, and others. So they are in the process of deciding what their plans are going to be for their future grid maintenance. And so we're working very closely with them to try and make sure that they align their investments with the local law 97 and other goals to try it, and bring it all together. But everyone's going to have to be within a close proximity of a vehicle charging station. And that's got to be, I think our Plan YC goal was everyone within 2.5 miles or something. But that also seems like, is that going to work? we're going to need a lot of that. There's a lot of work that needs to happen there, I'll say. But I think working with the utilities on this is going to be really, really critical.
If I can add on the private side, I think it's a yes and solution, which is we're starting to address demand response and peak shaving and using other resources like geothermal or ice storage or other things like that, where we're trying to build, and our residential tenants will sign a green lease because we'll be able to shut down all of their thermostats when Con Ed has a problem, right? They can override them, but we're trying to build that muscle through creating culture and education amongst the 450 residents that are gonna move into 505 State Street. So it's a little bit of education, right? And our first signage for the building said 440 electric cars, and we crossed out cars and wrote homes, because we don't think people understand what that means, right? What does it mean to live in an electric home, induction cooking being the primary, or electric resistance boilers or some of those other things? And so there's education. There's a lot of IoT technology that exists to shut down and to help Con Ed and to support them in moments of demand response, like when we need to do demand response. And then there's a handful of other great technologies in addition to solar that can help peak shave, right? Where we can start shifting the curve to moments where it's off cycle, right? Or take advantage of other energy sinks that are immediately available to all of us to just do a better job. All of us are gonna have to jump into that, especially as we head into a winter peaking system, which the city is not used to yet.
I would also add, in order to sort of address some of that reliability fears and gaps that's predicted, storage is really critical, and we have a very slow to develop storage rollout in New York City, and a lot of that's because we live in a very uniquely dense urban environment, and so there's a lot of concerns from the fire department about storage permitting, and that's starting to shift a little bit, but I think it's sort of a dire situation where we really need all hands on deck from all the agencies to figure out how we're going to get just lots more, backup battery storage to help address some of the grid problems and resiliency in general. And then the other thing is, I think, I don't hear enough about like pairing electrification with solar. And I know you're talking more about transportation, but, in all this move to heat pumps and induction stoves, in my dreams, we just give free solar to anyone who gets a heat pump, because that would help offset the burden on the grid that we currently have. And so I think there's the centralized, problem solving, addressing, how utilities are supplying energy, and some of the, energy saving, peak shaving policies, but also, the distributed solar and making sure we're sort of keeping up with any new loads by putting solar on rooftops.
Shannon, I'm going to pass it. Oh, you got it.
Thank you very much. This has been a great panel, really informative and insightful. Thank you. Majora, one of the questions you asked had to do with what are the impediments to achieving some of these goals, and I think the city and state do have these really ambitious and impressive goals to be carbon-free, carbon-neutral in 2050. I think the city creates such impediments to achieving that, and I don't see any energy in terms of reducing those impediments, and I think about rooftop solar, how difficult it is to do in the city for a small homeowner, because the fire department has its regulations, and I wonder if the mayor's office is going to be engaged on that issue, because I think there's such a tremendous untapped resource across the city for small homeowners to put solar up to provide a lot of their electrical needs.
Yeah, absolutely. It's a huge focus right now, because what you're saying has been true for so long, and it also speaks to the comment about why are we still here. You know, so we have right now something that's in front of the city council for approval, which is redoing our land use policy so that we can change what is available for building solar on top of roofs, for instance. So,
but what about fire department regulations too?
Right. Yeah, and we're working very closely with the fire department on this, and so they're very focused on safety, of course, and battery storage technology. And so we have the luck of working with a fire department that is very hands-on with these issues, and so they're we're working with them and the building code as well, and a process called BLAST to reform our land use and our codes at the moment, so that we can have more and more solar installations. But a big part of that is changing the rules so that it becomes more feasible.
Yeah.
And currently, when you're doing a building, if you might only be able to cover, you know, a small percentage of your roof in solar, and there's a lot of competing uses on solar, and it can't be visible from the street. And so, what the new rezoning proposals are doing, and they're, I believe it's out at City Council for comment right now, if you want to. You know, we're allowing for solar all over the, you know, for I think 75% coverage or 100% coverage of the roof, and you know, you can now see it from the sidewalk, and there are other things that have been huge barriers for installation that someone wouldn't do solar because it just gets too complicated.
Oh, boy.
Correct.
Yeah.
Sure enough. Thank you.
No problem. Thanks.
Thank you. So I think that's our last question, but this was really wonderful, and I just want to close with, I don't know how many times I was. Wasn't trying to count, but hand-holding came up a lot here, you know, in terms of, you know, working with utilities, you know, communities, just to, and although I think, Jared, you, it was more like arm-twisting to make sure that it was, but it was close to a hand. And sorry.
It's a contact sport.
Exactly. Tell me about it. But I really do think that the idea of you have to get really close to somebody in order to help make that happen. And if we're going to be moving into the new energy economy, it really is going to take all of us to really pay attention to how we can move things forward. And I'm personally really excited by everybody on the panel and the ability for you to do what you've been doing and to bring it out into the world, and especially how you've been doing it. So I love you for that. And really appreciate that you wanted to be a part of this conversation. And I'm sure in any way you're in lots of different ways, you're all a part of it as well. So thank you. We have to go, but I think there's food and beer upstairs. And I'm telling you, I told you it was going to be a great ending to this day. So thank you for being here.